Moving on to our next presenter and presentation, Luca Venturini will be covering the developments in the market of greenhouse gas and related activities. Luca's background is he is a senior manager in Accenture and responsible for its energy transition decarbonization offer for ICEG market, which includes Italy, Central Europe, Greece. And he has more than 15 years of experience in strategic consulting, research think tanks, innovative startups, and understanding of value chain challenges in several markets across Europe and Middle East. So, Luca, I will turn it over to you.
Many thanks, Heidi. Can you hear me well?
Yes, we can hear you.
Okay, so super. So, good morning, good afternoon, and good evening to everyone, depending on your time zone. Just I'll add a couple of words about myself. So the professional part has been already introduced and clearly described by Heidi. Just I'm married. I'm 41 years old. We have two cats and we are waiting our first son. So this is an additional responsibility and stimulus to work on sustainability in general on decarbonization and energy transition matters. Taking words from Rebecca Anderson, in a world on fire. So, when I have a speech, I love to start with the current situation. So, this is part of a campaign the majority of you probably have already seen. So, Show My Stripes, which clearly describe using colors, so blue means cold, red means hot, the evolution of temperature during the last 120 years. In this case, the image describes the evolution for Italy, but it is possible from the website to have a clear representation of the evolution of practically countries and location all around the world. And it's impressive, as you can see, the acceleration of red becoming dominant in the last 50 years, and in the last 15, 20 years, really red, dark red, which became a constant. So it's normal to be worried, but at the same time, someone may ask, is a novelty for the world this increase of temperature? So in order to respond, I'll use a research, an analysis performed by Burke and other of 2018. In absolute, is not a novelty, but the high temperature we are experiencing were common millions of years ago. So we are talking about Eocene, and the evolution we are seeing in just decades or in the last 100 years is something, and if we look to the future, especially is caring, is something which happened in the range of millions of years. So it's clearly difficult or impossible for an ecosystem to adjust at a speed which is not the usual speed of climate evolution across our world. So I'm definitely scared of the situation and this opportunity coming from Open Footprint to work together with first-tier corporation and competitor as well is a key opportunity because we have to work together in order to find a solution, a common response. I'll focus the discussion of the speech of today on three key topics. And then I'll leave a little bit of time for Q&A or in general for interaction on this matter in order to collect your feedback, your ideas, and have a little bit of interaction. So let's the three topics will be the coverage of the greenhouse gas under an emission trading system or a carbon tax at the global level. The record price for European carbon allowance we saw in last May, and the discrete court ruling of the last 26th of May. But let's start. This graph shows the evolution of the share of global greenhouse emission covered by regional or national or subnational initiatives, which may be an emission trading system or a specific carbon tax on a sector or on part of overall emission. It's clearly described by the data that for a long period, practically 15 years, the level of emissions, so after the 90s and until 2004, was really low. And just this year, we will achieve the record share of 21.5. But it's interesting to deep dive a little bit on this data. For the first period, only Nordic countries and Poland had emission trading system or carbon tax. I love to think that this environment created the condition of the success of several energy companies, which were able to rotate the business as Ørsted, or in any case, created the condition of a deep understanding from executive across energy or energy intensive industry, or also in general manufacturing company, and created the condition of the significant, I would say, activism of this company at global level. In 2005, finally started the European Emission Trading System, which until today has been the largest and more relevant emission trading system at global level. I'll focus the attention on specific trading system or carbon tax schemes. I know I'll not quote all the emission scheme in place. Their share of emission are included in the number, but I'll focus the attention only on the most relevant one. So in 2011, Ukraine joined the club. The following year, Japan and California. Then in 2013 was the time of the first pilot regional schemes across China. So Beijing, Guangdong, Shanghai, Tianjin, which were at the time quite polluted area and with a really significant and strong manufacturing base. It's impressive the change this scheme and strong regional or city regulation were able to achieve in just 6 years. In 2013 was really rare to have blue sky in Shanghai. In 2019 I spent 10 days and I was lucky to find blue sky every day, and Kazakhstan as well. The following year, Mexico, then Korea, and getting speed year after year to South American countries as Colombia and Chile, and to Canadian regions as states, Ontario and Alberta. South Africa in 2019 and this year China introduced an overall national emission trading system which covers up to 30%, 40% of the overall Chinese emission. Taking the level of overall global greenhouse emissions covered by any scheme above the psychological threshold of 20%. So, good progress, good acceleration, significant acceleration through time, but still a long road ahead. We are far away by 100%. We are far away, and at the same time, still really large emitters have not introduced or adopted a carbon tax or an emission trading system. At the same time, there are significant signs of hope. So, discussions are undergoing in several countries, so from Southeast Asian ones as Thailand or Malaysia, who are quite advanced in their discussion, to Turkey, and considering the political changes, I hope to see also United States taking a certain position which are needed for sure in order to have a common approach. And this data refers to the compulsory, so the regulated markets, or in any case to the carbon tax one. So I've not described the voluntary markets. It's a choice. At the same time, these markets are really active. And more and more corporation, so first tier corporation, are taking significant commitment to zeroing their emission. My company is one of these, so Accenture committed to net zero emission, scope 1 and scope 2, from 2025. And for sure, regarding power, it means usage of renewable or in general green power. But at the same time, for the emission, which we cannot I would say zeroing directly usage of offsetting. So it's definitely interesting the level of change, the level of evolution we are seeing, and more will come at speed. But coming back to emission trading system and carbon tax, I'd like to spend a minute looking at the variance of price at the range of price registered in 2020. So the minimum level was below $1 per ton of carbon emission equivalent. Which was clearly really low, not sufficient to drive change. But on the opposite side, the maximum level, $137 per ton, Sweden, is well above the corridor identified by World Bank, which issued a recommendation of 40 or a between $40 and $80 per ton of carbon equivalent. This level, this recommendation is sort of, I say, anticipation of the record of European allowance recorded on the 4th of May 2021. For sure, there are a lot of bullish factors which have been, I would say, a prime driver of this price, but also which push for a significant increase and really high forecast up to 2030. So Bloomberg, BNP Paribas are highlighting, are expecting prices between 90 and 100 euro per allowance, which is definitely a significant level, which is a shock and which is unsustainable for energy-intensive companies without a sort of fair competition level with competitor not subject to the same or at least a similar emission trading system. So probably we will face one of these two options. I hope, obviously, in the adoption of global or at least bilateral agreement, which means the most advanced nation in terms of economic terms, are competing, fighting at the same time climate change. Otherwise, probably we will see carbon duties at the border, which clearly is not efficient, and a potential harm for overall global economic growth. But what is energy transition in terms of bullish driver? Because European Union has clearly adopted really significant goals for 2030. So we are talking about a reduction of emission above 55%. We are talking about a share of energy coming from renewable sources above the 40% in 2030. We are talking about an investment related to Green Deal larger than 1 trillion. Looking at a smaller economy or a single nation, as Italy, we are talking about more than 70 billion of allocated by the recovery fund, which is in general above 200 for green economy. And energy transition, why is challenging? Because it's totally different from the previous one. So historically, we saw the discovery or the creation of a better energy source, so coal, oil, gas, in general, have represented an opportunity to increase productivity and reduce cost in a certain time span. So clearly, we can identify 50 years of innovation and then 50 years of diffusion. Today, we need to decarbonize consumption, which is by far more challenging than working on the supply of energy. We need to have a coordinated approach across the globe, which is, as we know, challenging because it means taking in consideration the different needs of country at the different development level and different investment capability, to take in consideration the need of a whole set of the stakeholders, which means complexity and the need to discuss, to take in consideration, obviously, energy poverty and, in general, equity consideration, because other ways will be much easier, but it's not acceptable by a societal point of view just to forbid certain use of old cars without providing incentive and support, or for example, not taking in consideration what does it mean the change for who works in an energy intensive company. So in our understanding, it means the need of significant changes both on supply and demand and across the whole sectors. And all these sectors have to adapt to a more costly energy environment, because in the end, if we increase carbon prices, if we need to finance a significant transition, in the end, in certain way, it will be more costly or will require a significant level of capex to support the transition. And this context is under an additional pressure. On 26 of May, I was personally quite shocked. Just to recap for who that doesn't work in the energy sector, so maybe as missed or not spent too time on the news, a district court ordered Shell to cut emission by 45% by 2030. For sure, I have the maximum respect for any court ruling, but at the same time, as a professional who work in the area and who loves to deep dive to understand the consequence of any decision of any relevant change, I tried to understand what does it mean. So in any case, the decision will accelerate Shell transition. So in case of appeal or in case of non appeal, no doubt it will accelerate a path already ongoing. So already defined, already communicated by the company. But as we can see, which was considered not sufficient by the court. At the same time, it means an increased climate and legal risk for international company, but also in general for energy-intensive sectors. And this is really tricky. I love to quote in this situation, discussing this topic, the word of Sheikh Ahmed Zaki Yamani, who was energy minister of Saudi Arabia and one of the key negotiator of OPEC. So he said 20 years ago a phrase which is used quite often. So Stone Age didn't end for lack of stone, and the oil age will end long before the world runs out of oil. At the same time, oil or gas demand or coal demand doesn't stop for a court ruling. So for a court decision. So what does it mean, this decision? An accelerated disinvestment, an accelerated fire sale from international company, and so not changing the fundamentals of supply and demand, does it mean a more prominent role for national oil company or for second or third tier or private company? But are these company able to operate with the same operational excellence standard of international company? Or indirectly, we are saying we are forcing corporation to sell these assets to company which will operate in I would say in a not perfect, or I would say in a not excellent way, these assets, so meaning more flaring, so meaning less attention to the environment e more risk for environmental disaster. In my mind, we need to leverage on the capability of international company and of energy-intensive firm. We just cannot close our eyes and imagine that the demand for fossil fuel will disappear by one day to another one. So I asked myself how this corporation should react to this ruling, and in my mind the response may vary by the specific context for sure, but it has to include at least these three elements. So, real time, bottom up, greenhouse gas data, No measurement, no capability to reduce emission. The adoption of a pervasive climate MBO for executive. So the pay, the variable part of the pay of executive need to be linked to climate performance. And this we saw in the past with the different challenges, but the need to reduce accident, the need to increase performance and so on, usually works. And then, for sure, we need to increase the transparency and adoption of internal carbon pricing. What does it mean? In my mind, it means including in all capital allocation decision a certain level of carbon pricing, and this level has to be disclosed. Has to be disclosed to clearly communicate which are the drivers of any strategy decision. But so what's the complexity at play? During this day, other presenters, other speakers have already touched the point, but I'd like to show just the complexity of putting together information and data real time, bottom up, from different systems, which already is complex, with the data, the information, the flows of commodities, or in any case of products, between one corporation and another one. So if we look at scope 1 and scope 2, the complexity level is in certain way lower or restricted to the border of the company, but when we move to scope 3, so looking at indirect, upstream and upstream and downstream, it means considering and working on data shared and aggregated, and in my mind open footprint is a key enabler, is a key actor of this vision. Stepping back to a potential recipe for decarbonization of energy and energy intensive company which operate in already existing greenhouse gas emission trading system, they have to focus and to work on three different initiatives level, I would say. So clean the core, so minimize the emission and maximize efficiency from current infrastructure and value chain. It means creating, guaranteeing through time the cash flow which are needed to accelerate the transition. So to replace today's sources of energy with cleaner and zero emission alternative option, and then to move to extend the frontier, so to scale solution and commercialize the technologies that today are not commercially viable. So when we talk about green hydrogen at to today's price needs support, public support. When we talk about carbon capture and storage, it's the same situation. But the investment needed which are huge, which are impressive, and the delivery capability which are required need the cooperation and the direct involvement of all the actors. So, first of all, in my mind, the energy corporation and the energy intensive company which created at the same time the prosperity of our age, but also the climate challenge we have to face. In my mind, in our mind, we are sure that industry can be net positive for the people and for the planet in general. Probably I moved a little bit fast across the slide, so I left a little bit longer time for Q&A, or I have saved 5 minutes for who started early the day at the end. So many thanks for your time. And
Thank
looking
you very
forward, obviously, your question.
Luca, very much. Thank you. There's one question we have over here. Can you hear me okay, Luca?
Yes.
Yeah, one question. Are there any active discussions regarding individual slash personal carbon tax based on consumer purchases like importing goods and habits, i.e. driving? Question mark.
Well, this is really an interesting point because for sure consumer choices are the one who will drive the decision and I would say the overall path. So I'm delighted when I see a company which offers the possibility to offset the emission related to a specific product. I'm delighted when I see companies which offer at a premium price the possibility to acquire green, for example, green electricity, which is quite common across the globe today. And I'm delighted as well when I see totally different company, for example, Pulper and Paper ones, which develop new technology, new IP for recycling in a better way products which currently are just a byproduct for landfill and are able to create a new product for 100% recycled one. So this is my response.
Thank you very much. Very clear response. Are there any more questions for Luca in the audience? Any questions? I find this very interesting presentation. It's, I guess, a little bit the end of a long day event, Luca.
Yes,
and it happens.
And Luca,
I fully understand.
Luca, excellent job, because you had quite a bit of content to go through and very complex at times. So we really appreciate all the efforts and everything that you poured into this. So really, really well done. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Heidi. Thank you very much to everyone.
Uh-huh. Yeah,
thank you.
What are your recommendations? So we do have another question that came in, and it says, what are your recommendations for OFP?
What do you mean by that?
Eve, can you elaborate on your question?
I don't see that question, by the way.
What are some of the actions we should take? Well, Actually, I don't know. Luca, if you would like to contribute, Johan, and I know Sammy's also going to come up and have some closing remarks and
Yeah,
and so.
these are very general. We can also talk about it more tomorrow in our access, where we, at the end of the day, we got more time about it, because these are very general statements at the moment.
Yeah.
But Tammy, maybe you can put up your closing comments for the day.
Yeah, I think so. I mean, I think if I can, because I appreciate it's late, and Eve, maybe to use your question as sort of that driver towards the closure. I mean, I think if we spend just a couple of minutes today thinking through what all we've covered, right? We've talked about the call to action, that urgency that we are probably hearing and seeing and sensing from the market and from governments and regulators and our customers and public and everybody else, investors, and that urgency is around being able to share and report carbon, I think. We've heard earlier from today around, from Gomar, around this establishment of a data model or data platform in order for us to be able to share and communicate this emissions related data. Saurabh brilliantly went through, the aspects of the architecture that we're building to support the collection and reporting and sharing of that. So we're thinking about it from a technology perspective. If you flip over to the business side, between what Shamuli and Luca and Anna provided, there's a lot of organizations, there's a lot of people that are working on this at the moment, and they're coming at it from different angles, but I think we're all converging to a likely convergence, which is greater transparency, greater accuracy, being able to share across the board, and recognizing that this isn't an individual problem, it's a shared and collaborative problem. So I think that's, maybe just a quick overview. And I think, between what Anna shared, from the WBCSD perspective, in terms of the actions that they're taking and the Pathfinder, and the carbon transparency and so on and so forth, with what Luca shared with the evolution of the importance of carbon, both from a, from a price perspective, i.e. in terms of credits, and as well as from a regulatory perspective, we're starting to see that action. Eve, coming back to your particular question, I think there's some very specific action. So I think, first of all, if I look at a global event like this, the best thing we can do is use this as an opportunity to collaborate and engage. I'll share more of this in my feedbacks in the recap session today, or sorry, tomorrow. But as I look through the questions and the comments and feedback, I mean, there was a lot of great engagement here today in terms of carbon offsets, specific needs for the maritime industry, even the question around the carbon impacts of the reference architecture and the impact on technology. I mean, these are all things that we need to and we should be considering. But we can only really do that effectively through this joint collaboration. So first recommendation I would say, and first action I would say, is continue to engage, continue to participate in dialogue. That's part of what this is. I will emphasize that it is the open group, and at the end of the day, we succeed by the joint collaboration of this entire team and all the companies and all the organizations that have been with us, from the start of the journey, that have joined us midway through the journey, and the ones that will join us, going forward, so to speak. So I think that's that. Eve, I think, and I apologize if I'm speaking specifically to you, but also to the wider audience, I would say I encourage everybody to continue to flag up questions. We'll only get better if we continue to raise questions, add challenges, and so on and so forth. As Johan mentioned earlier, I'm sure there's at least a few things that we probably, have either gotten wrong or could have done better, or there's probably some things in there that we've done really well, and to think about the positives. But once again, we're not going to know that until we get that input and that feedback. So I'm going to say continue to engage and input, and challenge, I think, is probably the second action. I think for tomorrow's session, because I appreciate we're almost at the end of the day and you're probably tired of me talking, especially those folks in Europe that are going, this is dinner time. And if there's anybody still in Australia, more power to you, because at this point I'd be sound asleep. But I think tomorrow what you're going to see is you're going to start to hear other organizations start to describe what do they plan on doing with it, and probably the action or the take home assignment for you guys tonight that are, and for those of you who are coming back tomorrow, is what am I going to do with this information? We have lots of companies, lots of people. I think at the high point, I think I saw about 140 people. It's 140 people around the world that are interested in understanding, reporting, and sharing carbon data. How can I now take that and do something with that in my own organization? Whether that's contributing effort, resources, thought leadership into the open footprint, whether that's taking some of the deliverables and sending that back out to the organization, into your organization, so to speak. And then finally, I think it's, what else can I be doing to contribute to this discussion and dialogue, I think, going forward. Okay. So hopefully, Heidi, I think a decent summary. Eve, I may not have answered everything in your question, I think, but hopefully maybe a good starting point, and maybe we can pick up on that on part two, I think, in tomorrow as well.
Thank you, Sammy. Thank you for wrapping that up and providing that overview and summary. That was wonderfully done. And Johan, terrific. If you have any last minute insights or any comments that you would like.
No, it's I enjoyed today. Mm-hmm. And let's wrap it up because it's 7 o'clock almost in Europe. And yep. Let me be there again tomorrow at 7 o'clock sharp Houston time, 2 o'clock, because we have a very interesting program again tomorrow.
Yes.
The demos with companies presenting what you're doing. So be there tomorrow, guys.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yes. Thank you. And thank you, everyone, for attending. And we will see you again tomorrow. John, if you'd like to add anything else, otherwise I will sign off.